prayer without ceasing, and then Anu was asking for more of an explanation or description over my experience with prayer. And I was raised in Christianity too, so I grew up with Jesus as a teacher, as a role model, and as a role model of praying, lots of praying, going off to the mount, going off to the mountains to pray and so forth. And at one point when I was working with A Course in Miracles, Jesus would speak to me very candidly, very friendly, and about all kinds of different topics, and also guide me where to go, who to see, what to say, what to do, when not to do anything. You know, it was very much, Jesus has always been my teacher. And with prayer, I remember asking one time, can you give me a context for what prayer is and what it looks like? I would like to also have a map of the mind so I could understand what's going on in the mind. And I was given these concentric circles, which culminated at the very core, which is the very core center being prayer. And what the circles were the outside circle, the outside ring was perception, the perceptual world of images that we perceive as human beings. And then underneath the perceptual realm, the ring inside that was the ring of emotions. And he said, yes, your emotions produce the world that you see. So if you have predominantly fearful emotions, you will perceive a fearful world. And to the extent that your emotions are purified and you experience love, then you will see the witnesses to love out there on the perceptual ring. So that was a very helpful start. And I said, well, what's all those other rings for? What's underneath there? There's a couple more rings, and then there's the core. And then Jesus said, underneath the emotions are your thoughts. And again, your predominant thought system, whether it's in alignment with God, which is a thought system of love, aligned with the Holy Spirit, will produce the love as an emotion, and also loving witnesses. And when you experience fear or doubt, shame, pain, hatred, you know, those are coming from thoughts. And there's an ego thought system that's underneath that perception. And all those emotions you experience, that roller coaster ride of emotions as a human being, are coming from thoughts. And you do have the power to control the direction of your thinking, but it will take a lot of practice, a lot of mental discipline to control the direction of your thinking. You have the capability. You have the potentiality, but you need a lot of discipline. Of course, Buddha and Jesus are examples of a very disciplined mind, a mind that has come under strong, strong discipline. So, underneath the thoughts, I said, well, what's underneath that are the beliefs. So you can believe things about your thoughts. You can actually have beliefs that will determine what your thoughts are, and therefore your beliefs are even stronger, more causative. They cause the thoughts. For example, you can believe that your thoughts are ineffectual. You can believe that you have thoughts that don't have any effect on the world or any effect on anything, and that's just dissipating the power of thought. Actually, thoughts are extremely powerful. And when you have a mind that was created by God, the thoughts are extremely powerful, but if you believe that they're ineffectual, it's part of a mechanism of hiding and pretending you're weak, pretending you're small, pretending you're a human being instead of a mind that's very, very vast that was created as divine mind by God. So there are thoughts, and you could say even your very identity is an idea in the mind of God. Christ's idea is not a perceptual, it's not Jesus the man, or it's not a man or a woman or masculine and feminine. It's just a pure idea that exists forever in the mind of God. But you don't know it when you're sleeping and dreaming. You have other egoic thoughts that are blocking the way to that experience. So that belief, the belief system of the ego, taints all those rings. Because as long as you believe the ego, which is separation, you will have thoughts of the ego, you have emotions of the ego, and you have perceptions of the ego. Even though those aren't your real thoughts, it's not your real emotions, and those aren't your real perceptions. It's a web of distortion that springs out from a tiny mad idea, a belief that you could separate from the source, separate from the one, separate from the creator. And what, I said to Jesus, what is under belief? Because we're getting down now. There are no more rings. There's only the center of the diagram, and that's prayer. Our power of prayer is our power of the mind. It's our power of desire. And at one point, Jesus said that he equated that center core with desire. So imagine that whatever you desire, you know, springs out into those rings. Therefore, the desire, there had to be, like Ian was talking about before, you were saying, I wish I could just forgive myself for that decision to think that there could be something more than my Heavenly Father. There could be something more. There could be another direction to go in other than eternity, or something else to experience more than infinity, more than love, something more than love, really. And there had to be a desire, there actually had to be a desire or a prayer for something more than everything. That is what the ego arose from, a desire for something more than everything. If you were everything, and there was nothing more than what you were in your creation by God, then the wish for something more, the desire for something more, is what the ego seemed to come from. So you might say that that's the core of prayer, that underneath the ego there has to be a desire for something more than everything. And Jesus says in the Course, truth will be returned to you by your desire, as it was lost by your desire for something else. That's a very powerful line. Truth will be returned to you by your desire, as it was for truth, as it was lost by your desire for something else. So I was like, wow, that's the core. That's what the prayer is. That power of prayer is everything. In fact, everything emanates from that. And literally, it's your prayer life that takes you back. And when Jesus said, let thine eye be single, he was really talking about, if you want your perception to be unified, if you want to see holistically instead of in a fragmented way, if you want to see in whole instead of in parts, you have to let thine eye be single, and you have to have your desire be unified. So in A Course in Miracles, Jesus says, miracles are for your birthright, miracles are everyone's inheritance. But purification is necessary first. So that's why he gave us A Course in Miracles instead of A Course in Revelation. You need a lot of miracles. You need a lot of purification, of convincing of your mind over and over and over and over, inspired by the Spirit, to reach a state where you pierce through the veil, or you literally transcend the veil of images. Because the Bible had said, hold no graven images before thy Lord thy God. You might say the ego has made up a cosmos of images. I always read the Bible, Adam and Eve, and then they have this sense of that they were naked. And then there's a fig leaf is used, so I call the cosmos the cosmic fig leaf. It's like a big fig leaf. I guess if you could get back far enough, you might see what shape it was. But it's a cosmic fig leaf because it's a cosmic attempt to cover over a shame or a fear or a guilt, which is what the fig leaf was covering over, something that was shameful. It's just on a cosmic scale. So in my life, I started to see everything starts and ends with prayer. It's all lined up with the prayer. And the prayer is where the causation is. And the prayer is not an activity. Like when I grew up in my Christian household, we would pray before meals, we would bless meals, we would pray at different times of the day, we would go to to Bible camp in the summer, and we taught how to pray. Oftentimes we were taught how to pray with the words. People, they would tell us what words to use to pray to God. I, like you, Anu, I kind of got into meditation and Eastern philosophy and was opened up during my 10 years of university into a wide number of spiritualities and teachings and philosophies. And I always, that was one of my questions, was how does prayer relate to meditation? Meditation seems to be very much the stilling of the mind and an opening and a receptivity. So when you would go into the stillness, you could hear. And I always associated prayer with more talking to God, growing up in a Christian, a Western context. So I could start to see the two coming together, that prayer was a mechanism of taking me also, like meditation, into that stillness, but also that God knew the prayer of the heart before a word was spoken. So again, it got back to God knew the desire of the heart. Now, in the Old Testament, there was one named David. Some of you remember from the Old Testament the Psalms and the Psalms of David. And my grandmother lived to be 99, and when she grew older and older, and she seemed to be diagnosed with dementia, she ceased to be able to remember things about the world. She couldn't tell you who had lunch with her. She couldn't tell you how her morning had gone, or whatever, but she could recite the 23rd Psalm. That one could not. Dementia, nothing could erase the 23rd Psalm from Lillian. She would grab one. She knew, I couldn't remember the whole thing, but she would just start, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And it strikes me that the beginning of that 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," that it's when our wanting, I mean in heaven or nirvana, there is no sense of wanting. Because when you want something, it's as if you don't have it. And you have and are everything in the kingdom of heaven. And you have and are everything in nirvana. So the wanting part is the part where the prayer gets splintered. You might say other things go on the altar instead of just experiencing yourself as Christ or yourself as one with God, like Jesus said, "I and the Father are one." These other things start coming on the altar. And that's what is experienced in the human condition. When some of you have read about Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs, very famous psychologist, and all those lower level needs, and the first level and the second level, are the things that most human beings identify with. That's what their identity are, these lower level needs. You know, what Fritz talked about, survival needs. And then as you move up from the basic needs, the first couple levels, then you start to move up into higher needs, more needs of the psyche, and ultimately you go higher and higher into sense of beingness or the sense of self-actualization. Knowing yourself, what is your identity? Really, you start off in the lower realms and you work through those as you work up to what is the question. Frances tells a beautiful story too of how she went back to China and how we were traveling over there doing a lot of Course in Miracles gatherings, but as I mentioned earlier, all of my writings got translated into Mandarin. So her mother got hooked on the website of all my teachings in Mandarin, and then pretty soon her mother read more and more and more, and she says, "Some of the stuff that David is talking about, you know, like he's talking about the world being an illusion." And then she proceeded on to the point of like, well, where does that leave us? What happened to our mother-daughter relationship in this? And then Frances spends the next hour and a half talking about the relationship of the dreamer to the dream world, the dream figure. And her mother listens with open eyes for an hour and a half as all this stuff pours through. Then that precipitated her mother, who was a devout atheist, started having mystical experiences after she spent that time with Francis, and more mystical experiences. How do I explain this to my friends? Don't try. Francis said, don't even try. Just open yourself to the experiences. It just shows how everything is a reflection, that the power of the mind, the prayer of the heart, was to know thyself, was to know spirit. And then her mother, who hadn't even dabbled in spirituality, started reading the teachings, and then actually after that very direct encounter, started having mystical experiences. So really the prayer is the prayer of the heart. And no one can pray beyond their own level of need and recognition. In other words, if you seem to have enemies, then there's the curious thing of praying for your enemies. And Jesus says, Jesus actually dictated a pamphlet. After he dictated A Course in Miracles, he dictated a couple of very helpful pamphlets. One was the psychotherapy pamphlet, Purpose, Process, and Practice, and then the other one was Song of Prayer, where he did a whole pamphlet on prayer. And he described it as kind of a ladder where, based on, if you perceive yourself as a human being with needs and wants and lacks, you can't help but pray for those things, because that's where your consciousness is. So it's practical and reasonable to pray for those things based on where your level of awareness is. And then he described a ladder of consciousness going higher and higher, and in which you may initially pray for like needs, and you may ask for gods, you may ask God to meet certain needs and so forth. And then you may start to pray for certain qualities. You may pray for patience or honesty, trust, and so on and so forth. And then as you go higher in the ladder, you come to the top of the ladder, in which you take all the parameters and limitations off of your prayer. As you grow consciously and your consciousness goes higher and higher, and you start to transcend these false egoic beliefs and false egoic thoughts, you go higher and higher, and finally you go to the top of the ladder, where your prayer becomes so purified that you're not, there's no supposition, there's no sense of trying to ask for anything. You come to a place of what Jesus calls, you know, the top of the ladder, which is, Father, what is your will for me? And you have to be ready to pray that prayer. If you still have prayer for other things going on, it means you're not ready for that prayer. But that final prayer is, Father, what is your will for me? And God's will for you is perfect happiness. But that happiness is not a perceptual happiness. That's more like the disappearance of the universe time, where your perception becomes so unified, and your mind is so unified, and your prayer is so unified that really you're saying, show me, reveal to me who I am. And God, being the creator of who you are, is the revealer. Human beings can't reveal identity, and nothing of the world can reveal identity, but the source, God, can reveal identity. So in one sense, it's very much, very similar to Buddhism, in the sense that Buddha taught you have to empty your mind of everything you think and think you know. And I found that A Course in Miracles was giving the same pathway, except it had a workbook, which was like a laboratory for practically taking a lesson a day and devotionally giving yourself over to say, show me the truth of this lesson, and then letting everything in your day be orchestrated to show you the truth of the lesson. So it became a way of, for me, emptying my mind. Some people use different, like Tai Chi or TM, different types of meditations. There's many, many techniques and many wonderful spiritualities. For me, it was the workbook of A Course in Miracles, where I just gave myself fully over to it. And I saw that nothing was at random, and that there were no accidents, and that whatever my lesson for the day was, as I was giving myself fully to it, I could see the circumstances teaching me the truth of the lesson. So like lesson 136, sickness is a defense against the truth. Of course, on the day that I was doing that, that's the day that I had symptoms. I had nausea, I had diarrhea, I was cooking a plate of food in the microwave, and all of this nausea came in, these feelings, and then this very strong diarrhea feeling came in, and I raced away from the microwave for the bathroom, ran down the hall, took a quick left, got on the toilet, and then as I was on the toilet, and I'm still in my prayer, because I'm always watching my thoughts, the first thing I noticed was in my thoughts were my thoughts. I'm probably catching the flu. I wonder if I caught it from my grandmother. I might have caught it from my dad. What's the next thought? I wonder if it's the 24-hour bug or the 48-hour bug. See, all these very past thoughts, egoic thoughts with causation going in. And then finally, after like five of those questions, I prayed and prayed, and then Jesus said, don't forget your lesson for the day. It's like, oh yeah, sickness is a defense against the truth. You see how orchestrated the whole scene was? The whole scene was orchestrated by Jesus just so I could practice my lesson. It was for one purpose, it wasn't for anything else. And that was so practical, because then I had to start going into my mind. Sickness is a defense against the truth, and I had just let related ideas from that workbook lesson, a very long lesson actually, start to come into my mind. That sickness was a decision, that I was just afraid of love, I was afraid of God's love, and I was choosing sickness as a defense to prove that I was little and weak and frail, and I was not as God created me. It was the no, not me kind of defense against the love. And then when I went into the decision thing, I could see that as I went deeper down in my prayer, I could see that I was making a decision. And it's like what Ian was talking about, you know, where I could see I was making a decision for the sickness. And I had to follow that route in, because there was some anger at myself around choosing to be sick, choosing to be wrong-minded, you know, choosing to deny love. So I went down deeper in that route. I kept praying and praying, going deeper and deeper. And we had really got down to the point where I loved Jesus so much. I just adored Jesus. And as I sat on that toilet, going down, 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 into the, that's an interesting down, 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 through the crud, through everything. Never thought of it. Very interesting metaphor. Then I actually saw that I adored Jesus, and that either Jesus had been truly guiding me and comforting me and telling me the truth all along, or Jesus was the biggest liar in the whole universe. And that it was germs and all these other things, catching the flu. It was either Jesus was telling me the truth all along since I was a little child, or Jesus was lying to me all along. And then I followed that route down, because I knew it had to be one or the other. You can't be telling the truth and be the biggest liar. It has to be one or the other. And when I got down to the root of that one, I just exclaimed, "This is impossible!" And as soon as I said those words, then the diarrhea, the nausea, everything absolutely vanished in this. It was one of those powerful miracles. It was a miracle, literally a miracle of healing, where I came from my wrong mind into my right mind. All the praying was coming through the wrong mind, coming down to my right mind. Because a lot of people say to me, who in their right mind would choose to be sick? And I say, yeah, got it. Who? No one in their right mind would choose to be sick. It's a guilty, wrong-minded decision. And I just had to get to the root of it. So it was a time of prayer. But as soon as I got to that point of truly loving Jesus and seeing he was telling the truth, or seeing he was the biggest liar, when I got down to that point, that's when the release occurred. And then that was very powerful for me. I mean, I got right off that toilet, pulled my pants up. I went out there. One of my thoughts was, now I'm not going to be able to eat my plate of microwave food. No problem. I feasted on that food. Because that was the miracle. The whole thing was just orchestrated for me to come into my right mind. You know, the whole thing was, that's what I call practical miracles. They have to have conviction behind them. It can't just be a wish, I hope, I pray, you know, kind of wishful thinking. It has to come down to the core of things. And then that miracle and other miracles that followed during doing that workbook, they just became more and more convincing that I was under no laws but God's. That's what all of the lessons were convincing me. That I had dominion over the world. Isn't that what Jesus said in the Bible? Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. I didn't, when I first read that as a child, I didn't know what that meant, overcome the world. But he was saying, your mind is so powerful that if you give yourself to that alignment with God, that the world can do nothing to you. You have dominion over the world. So you might say that it went on for days and weeks and months, and it continued on for years as part of a rinsing of the mind and as part of a convincing job. The convincing was that I am not a body. I am free. I am still as God created me. And that he even says in the Course, this phrase, you know, whenever you're tempted to be sick, I am not a body and my mind cannot attack, so I cannot be sick. Because it's the ego's trick of trying to project the false identity onto form and project it onto a body and onto the world to convince the mind of its tininess. That's the closed system of the world, that the five senses are part of a consciousness that was made to keep you feeling small, limited, little, tiny, not your vast Christ self, but a very small human identity. And then these miracles convinced me over and over, if I had an issue with a person, with the country, with the government, or whatever, Jesus would keep reminding me when I would be angry at a politician, or a political system, or the government or something, Jesus would say, it's in you. That government is in you. That person is in you. That environmental issue that you're so hot about, you're so angry about, it's in you, it's in your mind. But you have to use your power of prayer to get to the core, to have a purification where you see that there's only one problem, and it's an identity problem. You've forgotten who you are. You've forgotten how God created you. It's a huge identity issue going on, and you can splinter it out and put it out into zillions and zillions of problems on zillions of different levels, but that's still not going to resolve anything. You've forgotten who you are. And you need, this is your wake-up call now. So, I was told I wouldn't have a career. I was told many things that were really actually helpful, because then I didn't even try. If I'm not going to have a career, then, well, that's fine. And I had this discussion after I had 10 years full-time of university. I'm like, okay, that's enough of that then. I'm going to follow you, and you will direct me in all my endeavors as I go forth from here. But it's been very kind of almost, could say, magical. It's almost like the Beatles call it, the magical mystery tour is waiting to take you away. Waiting to take you away. That's how it felt when I said, okay, I'm on this adventure now. I want to learn how to forgive the world. I want to learn how to remember my identity. It's been a very magical mystery tour. The mysteries have started to dissolve away, though. It's becoming more like, oh, of course. I knew that. It just was covered over. Oh, yeah. It's like a remembering of the presence of God's love, and actually a forgetting. You were talking about angry at yourself for that decision to think there's something more, something better. Actually, I'm going to kind of like a spiritual Alzheimer's, a spiritual dementia, following my grandmother, who surged and led the way in my life, who was so happy that she would have the whole nursing home around her singing hymns from the Bible, and she couldn't tell you who she had lunch with. She went into extreme dementia where she forgot everything of the world, but would sing these inspiring hymns and would rattle off the 23rd Psalm. The Alzheimer's couldn't touch the core of what she was about. We think remembering is good and forgetting is bad. We were talking a bit this morning. Jeremy was talking about the frustration of forgetting things, the frustration of not being able to pick up the Zulu language in 3 years, or the skills starting to wane and not as sharp. I'm not as sharp. And my grandmother would always say it to me. She said, I'm just not as sharp as I was, David. And I'd say, it's working beautifully. You're becoming an inspiration to many. And you're forgetting. She'd say, oh, I'm such a burden. I said, no, you actually are not a burden. You're an inspiration. You know. So she was making that turn. What we find in our lives is we just need to know what we need to know. We're given what's necessary, and the rest we can let go of. We don't have to retain the vocabularies, retain anything. When I give these talks, it's just like the spirit is giving the talk and pulling from the pool of whatever's in there. But I don't often know where the talk is going. I'll even watch a parable start to be told, and there'll be a part of my mind. Years ago I was telling a parable and I was thinking, wait a minute, I don't even know where this is going. And Jesus is like, that's right, let me tell the parable. And, you know, it was like totally coming through me, but there was no sense of how the story goes, how it ends. And I even told a parable when I was in Argentina one time with two longtime friends, and they got to the point where one was translating for me the Spanish into the English for my ear. She was sitting on my left. The other was translating from the English to the Spanish. She was sitting on my right. I started telling this parable, and at some point in the middle of the parable, which was all English words, the Holy Spirit, Jesus, threw in this Spanish word of the name of the guy, Pedro. And it was like throwing a wrench in the engine. They were in such flow. One woman, they both had been classmates when they were 17, now they were in their 50s. They came back together, re-met through me, and they were best of friends now, and they're the closest of friends. As soon as I said the word Pedro, the one who was translating for me, she couldn't hear the word. I guess she was expecting an English word.
Yeah.
Peter or something. The whole thing was, I was speaking in English. She was like, she started looking at me. Then she looked at her classmate. What'd they say? We're in the middle of it. Everyone's waiting for the next line. What did she say? Pedro. What? Pedro. What? What? She could not hear the next word. The place, both these friends burst into laughter. The whole audience burst into laughter. Everybody started laughing so hard they were crying. And we never did find the end of that parable. We hit the laugh point. There was so much laughing and crying and laughter going on that I waited for about 10 minutes to see if it just getting louder and louder and louder. So finally, I said, we need to go. So that ended the whole thing. The whole room ended on a huge burst of laughter. It all filtered out. Then we went home, and each of them to their husbands. The husbands are waiting, you know, waiting up for us. It's like 11 o'clock at night. They walk in and they go, how did it go? The women burst. The men are like, what happened to you? You're never like this. And they just, and it went on that night, on, and it went on into the next day. And so that's also a line from the Course. The world will end in laughter. Because it was a place of sorrow, the world will end in laughter. So it gives you a clue of where this is all heading. To have one big, big belly laugh at the whole thing and not take any of it seriously. And that was the most extreme example of that. It went past the translating anything. It demolished the whole gathering. The laughter was so strong. And we've had that on this tour. We were in Finland, and they got this translator for me, and he was sitting right next to me. Francis was here, we were to do the translating. And he came from England, but he lived over there, so they said, you're really good with Finnish and with the English. So the Holy Spirit was so playful with him all the way through. At one point, we were talking about letting go of the self-concept and letting go of your thoughts and beliefs, like emptying your mind. And the line came through, The only thing that you need to finish.
The only thing to finish. There's nothing to finish except being
the belief.
Except being finished.
There's something. There's nothing to finish except being finished. it's the first time it ever came up. It's the first time it, you know, it's in Finland. There's nothing to finish except being finished. And it's the translator. He turns to me and he just looks and he goes, "No, I won't translate that." And so we burst out laughing. So he's translating, and apparently I don't know Finnish. So I'm just there in my dark self doing, and he's supposed to be translating. And these are people that have watched all my YouTubes for years, and they know my teachings and the course like the back of their hand, like the hair on their hands, and they know that. So every mistake he makes in translating me, they're just like. So the whole crowd is upset. So when we finally come to break time, people come up right in his face, you know. They're like coming up to tell him, "You've got to get better with your translations. It's terrible." They're calling out the translations from the audience. And he's just so willing and everything. So he's sitting there and they're kneeling down, but they're in his face. And my whole talk was on innocence, on perfect innocence. Meanwhile, he's doing the best that he can, and there are like two people in his face. So finally, they're right at his face there, and he just turns over to me and he goes, "Look at this. Look what they're doing." Yeah, we gotta let it all go. We gotta let the translating go. Let it all go to know your innocence. So we had so much fun, and that's what this whole tour has been. Now we're winding up this is the 11th country, but we've had so much fun just teaching joy and love and innocence in the state of mind that there's nothing that can harm you, nothing can disturb you, nothing can go wrong. That's what you were sharing. That was your insight. You can't mess it up. And that's the vibe of what we're extending with everybody, is you can't mess it up. Relax. Just relax and enjoy the ride. Let the spirit take you, and don't kick and scream and fight, because the current is taking you back to the ocean, and you're not really going to be able to do a damn thing against it. You can try to make it a difficult journey, but you know, you might as well enjoy it, because the stream is going back to the ocean. Everything flows downhill, and when we flow with the spirit, we can really enjoy all the trees and the rocks, and we can enjoy the bends. So that's my little snippet on prayer.
After this long confusing session,
your answer was confusing.
Her answer. We all therefore have different opinions, ideas, needs, aspirations. Did you say therefore in this whole thing that you can ask and pray for what it is that's on your mind? Because quite likely, as you said, what's on your mind is on your mind. And something different is on everybody's mind. So therefore you pray in your own mind to what it is. Or do you just say, "I give praise for what it is," with no wish to any prayer?
Well, I was saying you can't pray beyond your level of discernment and need. Just like that's what the Oracle told Neo in the Matrix. You know, you can't receive an answer beyond that which you're ready to hear. And so that's a beautiful quality. Like, for example, you shared your story about how you came as an immigrant, you did what you needed to do, not just to survive, but to thrive, to succeed, you know, to fulfill. And then you followed that out. And then when things just started to dismantle, and it dismantled further and further and further, that got down to the place where you lost your hope. Depression started to set in, and you started feeling hopeless and suicidal. Then again, through all of that, the spirit is there, and whatever seems to be appearing on the screen, on your motion picture, is really what you're calling for. It's somewhere deep down in your mind, you had a prayer. Maybe it wasn't even a verbal prayer, but there's something in your mind that was going, "Help, I'm going down, I'm losing it here, I need help." And just even, like we had a session, you know, in Joburg, and you were saying, you know, "I'm living at the back of my ex-wife's house," and I said, look, at least you got a roof over your head. He said, no, it's a shed. I'm in the shed. My ex-wife, I lost my house to her, and now I'm living in the shed. I said, that's great, you have a shed. You have a shed. You see how the spirit, and then being at the gathering, and all of you being so transparent, and all the people coming up, and then the gifts started to come in. Gift you to be at the weekend. I'll gift you to come down here, you know, to be here. So you see, this is how the spirit is working. Whatever you believe you are, whatever you have circumscribed yourself into these beliefs, the spirit is like this ray of light that's coming through and saying, help is here. And the help is all around you. You know, you even now with all these mighty companions that are here with the very same purpose. They want the sense of hope, they want this sense of a spark in their heart. They want a sense of a reason to live. We have to have a reason to live. We can't just go through the motions. It has to be a purpose. And that's the prayer of your heart, and that's what all this is about. And we have to just trust that the spirit will use whatever. It can use the trees, the animals, it can use the stories, the symbols. You may meet somebody or talk over breakfast. You did share with me that it was when I started talking about purpose. That's what really hit you up there in Joburg. That's what really helped carry you on to the next gift. But that's how it works. We just are given one gift after the next. And that's what our testimony is we've been gifted. We've just been intuitive and we've followed just the next step without looking too far ahead. Just follow the next step.